Okay, so Matt, Sandy, and colleagues, over to you if you want to introduce yourselves and share your screen and take it away.
Awesome. Thank you, Julie, and good morning, everyone. Thank you all for having us. Get my screen share set up here. Okay. Is that a full screen for everyone? Perfect. So good morning, everyone. Thank you all for inviting us to speak today. So my name is Matt Genova, and I'm here with my colleagues Sandy Johnston, Anne McGann, and Michelle Scott to discuss the work of the Boston Region MPO and how we can be a resource for your communities in all things transportation related. So here's the ground that we'll cover in the coming slides. I'll start the presentation with an overview of the MPO, and then we'll turn things over to my colleague Sandy Johnston to discuss how we fund studies and technical assistance through the MPO's Unified Planning Work Program, or UPWP. I'll take things back over for a minute during the middle of the presentation to talk about the Transportation Improvement Program, or the TIP. And then at the end, we'll turn things over to my colleagues Anne McGann and Michelle Scott to cover the MPO's long-range transportation plan. At the end, we'll share a handful of resources before opening things up for a discussion on all three major topics. So I'll start off with some MPO basics here. Very briefly, many of you are familiar with this, but just in case, because we all live here in the Boston region, that means we are a part of an MPO region. So the funding for the operations, as well as the capital funding for an MPO, comes from a combination of federal transportation funds and the required matching funds, which in our case here in Massachusetts come from the state. So MPOs are really tasked with three main responsibilities for their regions. The first is developing a long-range transportation plan, which sets a 20 to 25-year vision for multimodal transportation in the region. The second is allocating federal funds to transportation projects in support of that vision through the development of a TIP. And then the third is carrying out multimodal transportation planning and studies across the region through the Unified Planning Work Program. So on the coming slides, as I noted earlier, we will cover all three sort of major key focus areas for the MPO, tying these all together as sort of one unified whole. So a little bit about the MPO board, because the board does change a little bit every year. So we wanna make sure you know sort of who's sitting on the board now and also how you can get on the board if you would like to do so. So as many of you are likely familiar, all the MPOs in Massachusetts are chaired by the State Department of Transportation. Again, they provide that local match to the federal transportation dollars that the MPO allocates. There are a total of 5 seats on the board that are held by state agencies, including MassDOT, the T, Massport, and there are 22 board members in total. So on the local side, we have 12 elected municipalities. 4 of these seats are at large, while the other 8 are held by one municipality in each of MAPC's subregions. Obviously, we are here at the MAGIC subregional meeting, and MAGIC's representative on the MPO board is the town of Acton. So we certainly thank them for their service on the board. So there are also 2 permanent seats for the city of Boston, and then 2 seats for advisory bodies. Those are the Regional Transportation Advisory Council and the MBTA Advisory Board. And obviously, certainly not least, our host for today, MAPC, also sits on the board and is currently the vice chair. So a little bit about elections, if you're interested in getting more involved in the MPO from a board perspective. So MPO board terms are for 3 years, and each year there are 4 seats that are up for election. So the next time that the subregional seat for MAGIC will be contested is next year in 2022. And those elections happen in October. So if you think your municipality might be interested in running for an MPO seat, definitely talk to your chief elected official to gauge their interest. MPO elections are jointly administered by MAPC and the MBTA Advisory Board. Nominations for this current year's election, which is about to happen later this month, were due last week on October 1st. But you still have a chance to vote in this year's election, and voting starts on October 11th. If you're not sure whether your municipality has a ballot or if you want to make sure that you have one, reach out again to your chief elected official. They should have received one, and if not, you're welcome to reach out to Eric Barassa or Brian Kane to make sure you get that ballot. And they can also help you if you're interested in potentially running for a seat in the future and would like more information on how to do that. So just a quick update on sort of what's going on with board representation in the region. So the MPO recently undertook some outreach to understand how the elections process was working for communities here in our region. So in response to those survey results, the MPO decided to make sort of one big change to the overall board election process. And that is that going forward, only municipalities in a given subregion will vote for their subregional representative. So that's something to take note of as you all think about things going on in the Magic Region. And again, your seat is up for election next year. So as you all collectively sort of decide how to best move forward with your representation, you all will be voting for Magic seats as a subregion, and no one from other subregions will be voting for that seat. In the past, anyone from across the region could vote for each subregional seat, but now it's sort of just within the subregion, which we think is a more effective way for the subregions to sort of coalesce around a vision for their communities as a whole and leadership to represent that vision. So a little bit more about the MPO, and then I'll turn it over to Sandy. So the MPO's role in the region here is really to foster a transportation system that supports a multitude of the goals that you all work on every day: sustainability, public health, quality of life, economic vitality. And we wanna make sure that everyone can benefit and take advantage of our transportation system equitably. So what does that really mean for the MPO? For us, it's really about creating a set of robust transportation options to meet the diverse mobility needs across the whole region, which, as we all know, includes everything from dense urban communities like Boston and Somerville, all the way out to more suburban and ex-urban communities, places like Ipswich, Bellingham, et cetera. So we know that the needs across the region are very diverse, and there isn't really a one-size-fits-all solution, but the MPO is here and MPO staff are here to be a resource for you as you think about the needs in your community and in your subregion. We are here to help you address those to the best we can. So just in case it wasn't clear from the last slides, why should you care about MPOs? It's really that we're working on the same issues that you're working on that are impacting your communities every day. Things like congestion and reducing emissions, to enhancing equity and access to opportunity. And again, the MPO and MPO staff really want to be partners for you in helping you move forward the work that you're doing on the municipal level to make life better for the people who live, work, and play in your subregion here in the Magic Subregion. So it was a crash course in all things MPO. And with that, I will turn it over to Sandy to talk a little bit more about the UPWP.
All right, thanks, Matt. And hold tight there, everybody. I know we're throwing a lot of information at you really quickly, but I promise there will be a chance to discuss in a few minutes. So the first thing I'm gonna do is throw a link in the chat where you can read a little bit more about the UPWP while I'm talking or later. That's just the link to the webpage on our website about the UPWP specifically. So the point of this presentation is to familiarize you with the basics of the UPWP process. But the most important thing I'm here to ask you for today is ideas. Unified Planning Work Program, or UPWP, is the process by which the MPO turns your ideas into studies and technical analysis, and then hopefully eventually into something more concrete. So while I'm talking, and as I just said, there will be time to discuss at the end of all of our presentations, I'd be thrilled if you all were thinking about things you'd like us to be looking into. Matt, can we go to the next slide, please? All right. So the UPWP does a few things. Overall, the purpose of the document is to program the federal funding that the MPO receives each year for planning and analysis, lay out how it's gonna be used. So that includes the core programs that we are required by the federal government and by Congress to maintain, what we call certification requirements, what we call discrete studies, which are the studies that the MPO retains discretion to select every year, our technical assistance offerings, and ongoing support program budgets that kind of help us keep the lights on. Next slide, please. So the UPWP functions on a federal fiscal year cycle, which means that, very exciting, we just started the new federal fiscal year on October 1st. So we're really just kicking off at the top of the circle here. The new UPWP for the federal fiscal year 2022 has just become operational, is now the governing program budget for the MPO. And what we're really kicking off there is that second box on the right-hand side of the circle, outreach and engagement. And we're spending these next few months going out and talking to folks, developing ideas. We're gonna be doing a survey just trying to figure out what the needs are in the region, short-term, long-term, and what we can help analyze and what will go into next year's UPWP. That all will go into something called the UPWP Universe, which I'll show you in a moment. And then over the course of the spring, we will be going through the process of finalizing which studies the MPO is able to do and gaining endorsement of the document by the MPO board, then by Massachusetts Department of Transportation, and then by our partners at the federal level. So, as I mentioned, we're doing this outreach today. We're here, we're talking to you. And how does that work? Where does that go? So we're gonna kind of document everything that's going on, everything that you tell us. We run some analysis internally at the staff level. We talk to some people in our partner agencies to see what they're up to. And we kind of sort the input into two buckets. One of them, smaller ideas, smaller projects go into our technical assistance programs, which I'll talk about in a moment. And the larger ideas go into this document that we call the UPWP Universe of Proposed Studies. If we can go to the next slide. All right, so this is what the Universe of Proposed Studies looks like. It's basically a giant spreadsheet, and it has a paragraph length blurb of kind of every study concept that we've heard about, that we've developed internally, that some of our partners have talked to us about. It's got a budget estimate. It tells us who the idea was proposed by, and then it ranks, or not really ranks, but it correlates the studies to how much they support the goals of the MPO as laid out through the Long Range Transportation Plan, which you'll be hearing about in a moment. In some years, we have up to 30 detailed concepts that are in the universe. And this will usually be developed by February or at the latest by March. It'll go through a process of being revised with the MPO's UPWP committee and staff, and we'll go through and kind of sort through and figure out what we can actually do, which of these we can actually fund and have staff capacity to do. So these are kind of the highlight items, and I'll show you a few examples in just a moment. The MPO also maintains two technical assistance programs that are available to communities and to regional transit authorities, on occasion to other entities. Community transportation technical assistance is for helping out with roadway issues, pedestrian and bicycle issues. These are typically small projects. We're talking on the level of a $10,000 or $15,000 project at most. But the thing is, these are federally funded. You can come to us on a rolling basis and ask for help with something. We're not gonna be able to give you an advanced engineering design, but we can give you a conceptual design to help out with a particular intersection or a block or two of a street that can be particularly problematic. The Regional Transit Service Planning Technical Assistance Program is very similar, but it's really for helping out transit operators with transit-related issues with service planning, sometimes with like bus station access, that kind of thing. And if any of you have projects that you'd like to put forward, I'm happy to facilitate the contact with people who run these programs. There's also a link on our website, which I will throw in the chat. All right. Matt, if we could go to the next slide. All right. So just to get into the gnarly details for a moment, I mentioned that the UPWP is funded through money allocated by the federal government. And that's actually not entirely true. It's mostly funded through the federal government. So the vast majority of the funding comes from the Federal Highway Administration, the Federal Transit Administration. We also have a chunk that in the gray, in the pie chart there, you can see is money that is revenue received by the staff to the MPO for contract work conducted in partnership with the Massachusetts Department of Transportation, the MBTA, Massport, sometimes other entities. But again, most of the funding that we get here is this planning funds from the federal government. About 20% of those federal funds end up flowing to MEPC for transportation related work and to help support MEPC's engagement with the MPO. All right, so I'm just going to wrap up with a few examples of the types of studies that we conduct through the UPWP. And these are examples of what we call discrete studies, the ones that are selected, come from that universe of proposed studies and are selected by the MPO's UPWP committee and MPO staff kind of in partnership. And these are ones that are in the current 2022 UPWP, so they will be carried out between now and the end of September of 2022. So we put aside a little bit of money to help out with recovery from COVID-19. One of the things we found over the last year is that we were not able to respond as flexibly and quickly to emerging needs related to the pandemic that we heard from our stakeholders and partners as quickly as we would have liked to be able to do. And so we put aside a little bit of money dedicated to kind of flexible response for that this year. And you should all know that that's available. And if you have any transportation related needs coming out of COVID related issues, please do approach us for assistance. So we have one that we're very excited about, which we're calling Addressing Equity and Access in the Blue Hills. This was a study that actually was proposed by a coalition of nonprofit groups, mainly from the kind of Mattapan, Dorchester area of Boston. And they pointed out that for a lot of folks, it's hard to access the Blue Hills Reservation from Boston without a car, even though they are in close geographical proximity. And the idea here is that we have this study that will allow us to go out and do a little bit of service planning to help think about how transit can help access the Blue Hills, but also really to deeply engage with folks and hear their needs and really kind of integrate those qualitative and quantitative aspects of how to do transportation planning. Right. And similarly, we have a study called Identifying Transportation Inequities in the Boston Region. We have a robust transportation equity program at the MPO. We interrogate everything we do along the lines of equity, but often transportation planning equity processes are really only forward-looking. They only attempt to prevent making inequities worse going forward. So what this study is gonna do is take a step back and take a little bit of a historical perspective that says, what are the existing inequities of the status quo, and what can we do to kind of help remedy some of those things? How can we identify them, and what are some metrics we can use to analyze them and analyze projects as to whether they're going to help remedy those historic inequities? And this is going to include both qualitative and quantitative elements. So I think this is a very sweeping study, big concepts, and I think it could really help set the agenda for a lot of exciting work going forward. So those are some examples of the work we do through the UPWP. I hope that's prompting some thoughts in your head, and I'm going to hand it back to Matt to talk about the Transportation Improvement Program, or TIP.
Awesome. Thanks, Andy. So as Andy noted, we're going to talk a little bit about the TIP now. So as many of you are likely familiar, the TIP is the MPO's five-year capital plan. So the plan is produced annually, meaning that we're adding a new fifth and final year to each year plan, while the former first year of each plan goes into effect, and those transportation projects go out to advertisement for construction bids. So in addition to those projects that are directly funded by the MPO, which is really the focus of today's conversation, the TIP also includes all of the federally funded projects that are advanced by MassDOT, the T, and the region's RTAs. So you'll see sort of all of that together if you ever take a look at the full TIP. So when it comes to the MPO's portion of the federal dollars in the region, there are really six different types of projects that we fund. The MPO's main funding priority is complete streets projects, though we also fund intersection improvements, projects like rail trails, and other bicycle and pedestrian specific projects. The MPO also funds first and last mile projects through our Community Connections program, and we're in the process of rolling out a transit modernization program to fund things like transit station improvements and other small scale transit projects. And finally, we fund large scale projects of $50 million or more, or projects that are on major roadways throughout the region through the MPO's major infrastructure program. So this chart here on the slide shows the MPO's goals for allocating its funds in any given year across these six different types of projects that I just discussed. So in any given year, the MPO has about $110 million in funding to directly allocate to transportation projects in the region. So again, the MPO's main priority is funding complete streets projects, and the board aims to allocate roughly 45% of its funding, or in the neighborhood of $50 million a year, to those projects. The MPO funds major infrastructure projects at 30% of funding, intersection improvements at roughly 13%, and then we have 5% set aside each for transit modernization projects and bicycle and pedestrian projects. And then finally, our first and last mile projects through our community connections program receive about 2% of funding in any given year. The TIP likely won't reflect these proportions exactly in any given TIP cycle, but the goal is that, you know, over 5 years, this is roughly how we're spending our funding. So it gives you a sense of really the MPO's funding priorities. And so as you think about projects in your communities, you know, you can think about the extent to which those projects align with these funding allocations. So what are we currently funding here in the Magic subregion? In the federal fiscal year that just ended, we funded some new bike shelters near the West Concord commuter rail station on the Bruce Freeman. There are 5 projects that are funded by the MPO in fiscal 2022, which is, Sandy noted, the federal fiscal year that just started last week. I know several of these projects are projects that folks in the Magic subregion have been eagerly awaiting for a number of years. Those projects include Kelly's Corner in Acton, Phase 2D of the Bruce Freeman in Sudbury, and the Minuteman Bikeway extension in Bedford. There's also some improvements to Route 2A in Littleton and Ayer, and a parking management system at the Acton commuter rail station. Further out in 2024, the reconstruction of Foster Street in Littleton is also sort of on deck for construction. So these are all projects that are funded directly by the MPO in the current 5-year TIP, as well as the most recent fiscal year, which isn't in the current TIP, but is in the TIP that just concluded. So there are also several projects in the pipeline here in the Magic subregion. So one of the things that we're always looking for guidance on is the extent to which this list of projects in what we call the TIP universe reflects your actual upcoming priorities here in the Magic subregion. So if there are projects that are important to your communities that you don't see on this list, please do share those with us. And I'll actually come back to this a little bit more in a minute as to why this is particularly important right now. So in lieu of talking about the sort of regular TIP process, which many of you all have heard about several times over, I want to spend the next few minutes discussing some changes that are currently underway with the MPO's TIP process. So the first is a series of changes that the MPO has proposed in response to recent project cost increases. So without going into too much detail, but any of you who have followed recent MPO TIP cycles probably heard much talk about this problem in recent years. But the long and the short of it is that the MPO has been unable to fund many new projects over the last couple of years due to cost increases for projects that have already been allocated funding in the TIP. So in response to that, the MPO formed a committee this summer to propose policy changes at the MPO level. So among the proposed solutions that the committee came up with are that first, that projects would be required to submit 25% design plans to MassDOT prior to being funded in the TIP. So MPO staff would still score projects prior to the stage. So if you do have a project that you're looking to move forward and you want to know how it would stack up to other projects under consideration for funding, your project could still be scored and that score would still be shown to the MPO just as it is now. But the project would not be quite eligible for actual inclusion in the TIP until you get closer to that 25% milestone. And the hope here is that this early scoring will help offset some of the uncertainty at the municipal level of not having capital funding lined up for a project earlier. Other changes here are that MPO staff would establish more regular check-ins with project proponents to try to address cost or schedule issues before they become severe issues. And projects that do see significant cost increases would go through a sort of reevaluation or rescoring process before the MPO would cover that cost increase. And that stands in contrast to current or historical MPO practice, which is that pretty much any project in the TIP that saw a cost increase would just have that increase covered. As it's sort of clear, that practice is not super sustainable if our goal is to move more projects through the TIP pipeline. So these are not insignificant changes, obviously, but they are really meant to create a more rational, predictable process in the long run, which we think overall should benefit all municipalities. So one of the most common refrains that we've heard in recent years from municipalities, again, sort of a time where very few new TIP projects were funded, is that the lack of available funds is creating a lot of frustration and uncertainty at the local level about any given project's prospects for TIP funding. So we have a lot of projects that have been scored for 2 or 3 years in a row, but have not been able to move into the actual funding pipeline due to lack of available funding. And so this sort of uncertainty of any given year, whether or not any funds will be available for new projects is not really fair to any municipality. And so the hope is that by sort of mitigating some of these cost increase issues, we create a process that works better and is more transparent and fair to all municipalities in the region. So these changes are not final. They're still in proposal form. And we certainly welcome your feedback and comments on them over the next 2 weeks. They're currently out for public comment. And I'll note that we're also hosting an open house next Thursday, October 14th. If you'd like to learn more about these specific changes and sort of provide comments or talk through them and how you think they might impact your community. So we're happy to continue that conversation after today, if you'd like to do so. And then I want to provide a couple of updates on our Community Connections program as well. So we are 2 years into the rollout of this program. So we've completed two funding cycles. And now that we're at that stage, we're sort of looking back on the first 2 years and understanding what could be improved to create a more streamlined process. So again, these are sort of proposed changes to the program that the MPO is currently vetting. But one of the big changes is that we're looking to partner with MAPC to move towards a collective purchasing model for small capital projects that are funded through this program. So the goal here would really to be create sort of a menu of options that your municipality could pick from for you know, small dollar capital procurements that would then be funded with MPO funds. And then we're also looking at changing the way we handle small like shuttle or microtransit projects through the Community Connections program, proposing that these projects are now done sort of directly through an RTA rather than handled sort of at the municipal level or through something like a TMA. And this would help just make these projects much more sustainable in the long run in terms of their ability to be administered by sort of MPO and MassDOT staff, which we think is critical to the sort of long-term success of the Community Connections program. So again, just like the TIP policy changes that I just talked about, these changes are also not final, and the MPO will continue to discuss these at their meeting on October 21st. So feel free to attend that meeting if you wanna learn more about this, and you can also provide comments at that time if you'd like to do so. We also anticipate more guidance coming out about the Community Connections program later this month or early next month. So please be on the lookout for that if you all are interested in applying for funding for your municipality. So big topic of conversation here, but I'm gonna try to keep it short and sweet. I wanna briefly touch on what's going on at the federal level, even though nobody really knows what's going on at the federal level. What we do know is that thus far Congress has failed to pass the bipartisan infrastructure bill that's been open for debate for a number of months. So the FAST Act, which is our current funding authorization for all the funding that funds the TIP and other federal projects in the region, is currently on its second extension. So actually this whole past year was extension number one, and now we're currently in sort of a 30-day extension that began last weekend. Meaning that current federal funding levels for projects and programming will continue unchanged through the end of October. So that's great, we're currently funded, but obviously the big question is what happens from here. So among many other changes in the proposed bill that is still under consideration are an increase in federal formula funds, which again are the funds that directly fund the MPO. So at sort of the current proposed level, there could be as much as a 25 or 30% increase in TIP funding in the region. This is sort of a back of the envelope calculation based on what's in the bill. And we don't have specific guidance on this from anyone, you know, at the federal level, given that the bill is still a draft and not finalized. But because there's this sort of potential influx of new funds that could be coming over the next several years to the region, I really cannot emphasize enough how important it is that you all begin the project initiation process for any projects that you would like to see moved forward in the coming years. So the MPO and MassDOT, you know, sort of in partnership, can't fund projects that are not initiated and approved by MassDOT's project review committee. And really without these projects initiated, it's impossible for us to know what the immediate needs are in the region. So if you do have projects that you're considering trying to move forward in the coming years, please reach out to me directly so we can start these conversations ASAP. And as I noted, when I showed that list of projects a few slides ago about, you know, sort of projects in the pipeline in the region, if that list is not reflective of your priorities, if there are things that should be added to it, the sooner we know that, the better, and the more we can sort of plan around it. So please do let us know. So I'll close out with just a few upcoming dates here. Again, if you'd like to submit comments on the new TIP project cost policies, that public comment period is open through the 18th. And again, we're also hosting an open house on the 14th to talk more about that. There is a MassDOT project review committee meeting coming up. So again, if you have a project that you are sort of in the early stages of, come talk to me if you wanna know how to get your project formally approved by MassDOT. And then we'll get into the TIP, formal TIP process later this fall. We'll host some information sessions. So please be on the lookout for more information on that in the coming weeks. So with that, I will turn it over to Anne and Michelle to discuss the long-range transportation plan.
Great, thanks, Matt. And good morning, everybody. My name is Anne McGann. Michelle Scott is also here, and both of us together are managing the development of the MPO's next long-range transportation plan. Next slide, please. So we're here to talk about the third certification document developed by the MPO. The Long-Range Transportation Plan, or LRTP, is required by federal legislation, and it must be a financially constrained document. The LRTP is the document that establishes the MPO's vision, goal, and goals, which are the basis of the criteria used to select transportation projects in the TIP and studies in the UPWP. It also establishes the transportation investment programs and major projects that will be funded in future TIPs to meet the MPO's vision. So the LRTP is required to be updated every 4 years. The current plan, Destination 2040, was adopted in 2019. And we are now kicking off the development of the next LRTP to be adopted in spring of 2023. So we have a brochure that summarizes the current plan, Destination 2040, and that link is provided in the chat. Next slide, please. So the next plan will be called Destination 2050, extending the planning horizon year out to 2050 to coincide with the other planning activities in the area, excuse me, including MAPC's Metro Common and the Commonwealth's Global Warming Solutions Act. Next slide, please. So I want to give you a quick overview and schedule for the development of Destination 2050. So as I mentioned, we are currently implementing the recommendations of the current plan through our UPWP and TIP and other MPO activities. The implementation of Destination 2040 will be ongoing until the new LRTP is adopted in 2023. So the first step in developing the new LRTP is to identify the region's transportation needs. And this includes two tasks that we are starting to work on now: developing the needs assessment for the region and conducting exploratory scenario planning to consider possible futures. And we'll be working on this through 2022. Then we'll revisit the vision, goals, and objectives using information that we have collected while identifying the needs in the region. And this work will also be ongoing through the end of 2023. And then we'll prioritize investments using the available federal funds beginning late in 2022 and into 2023, and then have the final plan adopted in 2023. Next slide, please. So today we want to focus on the key questions shown here. What transportation challenges and opportunities do we have today? And what challenges and opportunities might we face in the future? So the LRTP will address these through its needs assessment and the exploratory scenario planning process that we will undertake in the LRTP development. Next slide, please. So first, in exploratory scenario planning, we will explore possible futures that may occur in the Boston region. This summer, we conducted the UPWP study that we called the Big Ideas Study, and this included holding a number of focus groups with the public to solicit their ideas for potential scenarios that the MPO should explore as part of the next LRTP. Some of the ideas that we heard include looking at the future of remote work from home policies, transit expansion, resiliency of the transportation system, and what the population housing and employment might look like in the future. So we'll be presenting input from the Big Ideas Study to the MPO, and currently that is scheduled for the MPO's November 4th meeting, and you are all welcome to attend. The agenda will be posted on the MPO website on our meeting calendar. So the Big Ideas presentation will begin the discussion on scenarios, and the MPO will then prioritize scenarios for staff to analyze. And then this information will be used to make strategy recommendations for the LRTP. Next slide, please. So the other task is the development of the needs assessment, which we'd like to focus on today. The needs assessment includes gathering input from the public on their transportation needs, researching information from past and ongoing studies, and conducting analyses on various topics. So we will gather information and identify needs by MPO goal areas, which are shown here. So today we'd like to hear from you on the transportation needs in the region. So to help out, staff put together a subregional booklet, which some of you may have seen at past meetings. This one is dated 2020, but Sandy can provide updated information on studies and you have that have been done in the past, and Matt actually provided the projects in your region that have been funded in the TIP. It also includes the input that we have heard in past meetings on your transportation needs in the region. And the link to that booklet is included in the chat for you to take a look at. Next slide, please. So this slide shows some examples of the needs that we heard from you in past outreach. And all of this information is included in the booklet. So for roadways, we heard that you wanted to add dedicated bus lanes in all major infrastructure projects and incorporate complete streets designs into roadway projects. For transit, to support the MBTA's rail vision recommendations, expand transportation for seniors and low-income residents, coordinate MBTA service with RTA service, provide off-peak transit service for employees, increase bus service, and support transportation management associations, to name a few. For bicycle, you'd like to improve and connect the bike network in the region and encourage businesses to support bike share. For pedestrian, create more walkable communities and update the sidewalk database. And for parking, implement the Crosstown Connect model, support parking applications, and add more parking at commuter rail stations. Today, we'd like to hear from you on additional transportation needs. We know a lot has happened and a lot has changed in the last year and a half, and we'd like to hear what your priorities are now. Next slide, please. So with that in mind, we are asking, are the transportation needs you identified prior to the pandemic still priorities for you and your communities? How have your needs and priorities changed since the start of the pandemic? And what transportation challenges and opportunities do you see on the horizon, both near and long term? So before we get into questions and discussion, this next slide gives you a list of ways that you can stay engaged with the MPO. You can do that by signing up for the MPO's email list, following us on Twitter, Instagram, Facebook, and LinkedIn. And you can also check out past MPO meeting recordings on YouTube. And then this next slide shows our contact information in case you have questions or additional comments after the meeting. So with that, I'm going to open it up for discussion on the needs assessment for the LRTP, but also address any questions or comments that you may have on the UPWP and TIP. Thank you.
So, do we have any comments? Anybody have questions? If you just raise your hand, we can get you in. Must have been pretty complete.
Raise your hand. That's what I wanted to do.
I think, Bill, there's a bunch of hands raised.
Oh, I can't.
Can you see those?
No, can you call them out?
It looks like Jennifer, you might have your hand up first.
Yes, thank you. I was curious, going back to the, I'm trying to find where it was here. I guess the examples of technical studies, and you were talking about that the equity and access was one that's currently on the work plan. And I was just wondering, what that study encompasses, and is it looking at accessibility from more of a physical standpoint or more from a affordability or both? Sort of what the focus of that is, because something I think about is being on a commuter rail stop, that we often think about the commuter rail just going into town, but that it actually could be a good way for people to access jobs, you know, out of town. And so I was just wondering what that study covers. Thanks.
Yeah, that's a great question. So it's actually kind of a mix. I will say it's very focused on that one geographic area of the Blue Hills Reservation, and the transit services that run through the Blue Hills Reservation or could plausibly run through the Blue Hills Reservation are local buses, mostly from the MBTA, but there's also a Brockton area transit route that traverses the Blue Hills. So it's talking mainly about how to improve service on those bus routes. I think particularly we're gonna be looking at weekend service, which is much less prevalent and frequent in that area. But you know, I think, and this is I think part of what you're getting at, is that this could serve as kind of a paradigm for looking at this type of question throughout the entire region. This is the first time we're tackling a study along these lines. But questions like, you know, is it accessible to get out to an area of recreation or a reverse commute job by commuter rail is not just a question of service. It's not just a question of, does it physically exist? It is also a question of, is it affordable? I think the affordability question is not as high profile with this study, but that's not to say that it won't be tackled in kind of future iterations that we might take on of something similar.
So, Adam, I think your hand's raised.
Sure, thanks, Bill. Just a couple of things on what's on the slide. I think, you know, in our area that transportation needs have sort of stayed the same or you know, actually some of the things maybe they've been boosted to a higher level of priority. For example, you know, like, you know, outdoor recreational transportation opportunities like rail trails, things like that. But one of the challenges that I see like moving forward is, you know, the pandemic's created this environment where people are very fearful, I think, even still, of riding mass transit. And I thought, you know, we've made a lot of headway over the last 20 years. And I think we've taken a big step back. And I think people are going to be more inclined to just get into their car and go where they need to go, especially with more people working remotely. So I think there needs to be, you know, some outreach or some incentives, you know, to get people to, you know, still want to ride mass transit. So I think that's going to be a challenge, you know, as we transition out of the pandemic and for the, you know, next 5 to 10 years.
Margo?
Hi, everybody. I just wanted to ask Matt a question when you were going over the TIP process. Could you speak to how the MPO supports cooperation between neighboring towns when a project has impacts beyond just the strict site location? And I'm thinking particularly of the Route 422 Hartwell Avenue project that you previewed for an upcoming year of the TIP. So that's right on Bedford's doorstep, but it's obviously it's a Lexington project, a TIP project. So I was just sort of wondering, what is the MPO doing to help towns take a regional or corridor approach when you have a project like that, which will impact another town pretty significantly? Is there anything that you're doing to support that?
Yeah, thank you. It's a great question. I guess the short answer is that at the MPO staff level, you know, resources are sort of limited to do a lot of like really in-depth coordination across municipalities. But I think we hope that venues like this are ones where we can start those conversations and sort of, you know, if there's a need for a project like that that's coming up that, you know, requires slightly larger coordination across municipal borders. Perhaps those are needs that can sort of, you know, bubble up during these conversations, and then things that we can have, you know, sort of more focused, like follow-on conversations as needed afterwards. And so I think, you know, from the MPO's perspective, again, we don't have a ton of resources to sort of proactively do this, but I think if we hear needs from a municipality, like, hey, we're concerned about this project, you know, what can we do? Or, hey, we're thinking of another project in our community, that might tie into this, what can we do? You know, I think we do want to be a forum for helping to facilitate those conversations. So I'd say, you know, if there are more resources we can provide to you to help facilitate that dialogue or, you know, address those concerns, we're certainly open to hearing those. And so please do let us know if there are ways that we can be supportive beyond sort of what we're currently doing, which is just, you know, sort of getting information out there about, you know, what's going on in the region and then helping, you know, those individual projects move forward. So we're always open to feedback if you haven't.
I just will follow up because the whole 4225 corridor has been pretty widely acknowledged as being one of the most, you know, one of the areas in our region that sees the highest levels of traffic and needs the most attention. So I know, I realize this is one project within the corridor, but I do know that that's something that's on the minds of even not just Bedford people, but I'm sure Carlisle people as well, because a lot of your traffic goes right through that. And there's several bottlenecks and it impacts all of us. So I think the TIP process obviously is very sort of focused specifically on the infrastructure improvements that are in the site area. But I hope that the MPO is looking for ways to really help communities work together on the downstream opportunities, because a lot of times what you're talking about is a project that doesn't stand alone. It could really meet up and match up with some other projects that might either be stimulated or could be coordinated if we had the right framework for doing so.
Okay. Yeah.
That's great. Actually, I'll just jump in with another quick comment and say, I mean, thank you again for sharing that. And I think, you know, this is also getting to sort of the role of the UPWP and our, you know, technical assistance work in the region. Perhaps this is, you know, a role that that we can play there by helping to facilitate a broader conversation or perhaps even a study of several municipalities and how, you know, some projects might fit together. Maybe we can continue this conversation.
Okay, we have two more questions. I'd try to get to them real quick. Paula?
Thanks, Bill. I have a question. One of the slides was talking about, you know, usually when we have these discussions, we're very forward-looking. And I'd like to look back at existing infrastructure and the barriers that exist for people to use transportation. So for instance, in Lincoln, we have an MBTA station that is split inbound and outbound or on different sides of the street. People would sprint across the street to catch the train, which is very dangerous. And the other thing is it's not ADA accessible. And you know, these are basic things that were supposed to be addressed years ago. And how do we get the appropriate people to focus on fixing these kinds of issues? Because I have had zero success trying to get anybody to focus on the fact that our station is not ADA accessible for years, and just totally frustrated and at a loss.
Yeah, so yeah, I can take part of that. We're a good place to start, right? If you get that type of a project or that type of question on our needs assessment on our agenda, if you ask us to maybe study it a little bit, one of the things we can do, even if we don't necessarily have the capability to fix it through the MPO's own capital programs, which given that we have this transit modernization funding program that'll be debuting in a few years, and maybe we'll have the capability to do something through that. But even if we can't tackle it ourselves, we can help you get it on the agenda of MassDOT or the MBTA, because we're in constant touch with those people. We know who the contacts are within those very large organizations, which are often impersonal and hard to deal with. And we're happy to kind of help connect municipal folks with the people in those agencies. I was actually just emailing with somebody on the MBTA's rail transformation team about improving stations earlier this morning. So want to reach out to us, we are happy to help you make connections. Some of my colleagues may have other things to say also, but that's my contribution.
Thank you, Sandy.
And last question, Kate.
Hi, thank you, Margot, for asking a question. You did, because that was one of my questions. And I hate to be always whining. Carlisle always seems to be kind of the orphan. First of all, we are a member of the LRTA and not a part of the MRTA. And so I guess one of my questions is, are there going to be any moves towards, you know, making some more cooperative links between the LRTA and the MRTA? That would maybe help us. And I also just wanted to remind everybody, Walden Pond used to have a train stop, so that would be easy to do if they wanted to connect Boston with another recreational area. It used to be there, they took it out.
Yeah, definitely smoothing over connections between different transit providers is one of the things we're really taking a hard look at. And one of the other hats I wear in addition to managing the UPWP is managing the MPO's transit working group, which is another link I will throw in the chat in 1 second. And we actually have a meeting coming up on October 12th for that. I think I mentioned that in the chat earlier. And that's what this transit working group is really intended to do, is to make sure that those boundaries between transit providers are not as disruptive to actual riders as they sometimes can be.
Okay, I think we have time for one more question to stay on schedule. Bob, you wanna jump in?
Just, yes. Again, sorry, I can't be on video today, but Margaret brought up the impact of the Lexington Harwell Avenue rezoning. And just to briefly mention that we rezoned to much taller buildings, 115 feet to accommodate 6-story lab buildings. And that rezoning is not only on Harwell Ave, but includes properties on Bedford Street. And traffic through Bedford is a nightmare during rush hour for me as well. I'm on the Bedford side, so I have a Bedford-centric life. And we have a proposal in front of us for a new lab building at 440 Bedford Street with a 6-story garage. So that's coming, and it's just a major site plan review. It's not a no type of situation. So that's coming, and I just want to let everybody know that Lexington does, and we have our 25% design in process for that corridor and that whole area. So it's going to become very, very important shortly. Within a couple of years, that building will be up. So that's just a brief update.
Okay, great. Okay, we have a few minutes left. I'll ask for our MPO team. Do you any other next steps, or does the any other next steps you're thinking of that we should be aware of?
We would love to hear from you on these questions. I know we just threw them out today, and we also put the booklet up. So we would love for you to review that booklet, ask any questions, and provide any new priorities to us so that we can consider them as part of our needs assessment.
Matt, do you want to throw up the slide with contact information and stay engaged?
Okay, well, thank you so much for the visit today. It's very informative. I think everybody really enjoyed it. Looking at the comments, it seems like they did on that. Anything else before we move into our next topic on this?
I guess just to clarify, Anne and colleagues, so we can send out the contact information and people should reach out to the person about the specific program they might be interested in. And then the booklet, I'll just repaste the link here. The idea is review the booklet, email feedback, set up a phone conversation if you'd like to share your input.
Yes, that would be great.
Okay, great.
Great, thanks again.
Thank you.
All right. So are we going to go right into the ARPA, or do we have a legislative update on this for the?
I think Kasha is going to provide both of those. So okay. The RTA advocacy bill update and then the ARPA funding update.
Okay. I think, I don't know if everybody knows Kasha Hart, policy analyst from MAPC, but welcome back, and it's all yours, Kasha.
Great. Thank you so much, Bill. Hi, Magic folks. It's really great to see you all. It's been a while since I've been at this table, so it's good to see a number of familiar faces. I think I will start off with just a quick update on the RTA advancement bill and then move into ARPA after that, because there's
plenty to talk about related to ARPA. So with respect to the RTA advancement bill, that bill had a hearing. It's in the Joint Transportation Committee, and that bill had a hearing back in July. The hearing was, the testimony was really, really well received. The Massachusetts Public Health Association is coordinating an RTA advocacy coalition, and they did an excellent job coordinating testimony on the bill. And my interpretation was that it was really well received by the committee. The committee has not yet moved the bill. I don't know that they've actually moved any bills this session yet. Really, as we'll talk about in just a couple of minutes, the whole ball of wax in the legislature right now really is ARPA. But I'm hopeful that once the details of a federal infrastructure bill become a little bit clearer, that may spur a little bit more activity in the legislature with respect to different kinds of transportation investments. Also, just so this group is aware, as I'm sure you've seen in the news, Senator Von Cory, who was the Senate chair on the Joint Transportation Committee, has left to take a position at MassBio. So the Senate currently has a vacancy in that seat. And I don't think that will be filled until Senator Von Cory's replacement is elected. So that'll be sometime. What that means for the movement of transportation-related bills in the legislature, that, you know, remains to be seen. But again, I think the main focus right now really is ARPA. If you are interested in getting more engaged in RTA advocacy, I'm happy to put you in touch with the folks at MPAJ who are leading a lot of this. Just send me an email afterwards and I can connect you with Alexis Walls over there. And then just one quick thing too, the legislature actually vetoed or overrode the governor's veto of RTA funding in the budget. So RTAs for the FY22 budget are funded at $94 million, which is aligned with what the advocates have been asking for. $90.5 million is going just directly to operating funds, and then $3.5 million is going to, will also be going to RTAs, but distributed based on a formula, not based on performance grants, which is what has been utilized in the past. So some good RTA news to share. Jennifer, did you have a question?
I was just wondering if there's a specific bill number that we should be following. If you have that.
Yeah, that's funny. I had this open because I thought the question might come up. I'll drop this in the chat right now. Sure.
Thank you.
Senate Bill 2277. So filed by Senator Chandler on the Senate side. And then I was just writing this down. And then it's House Bill 3413 filed by Rep. Light on the House side. Good, longstanding RTA supporters in the legislature. All right, any other questions about RTAs or sort of what is happening in the legislature right now before we dig into ARPA, which is really what is happening in the legislature right now? Okay. Oh, thumbs up. Or do you have a question for me?
No, I just wanted to sort of second what Kate Reed said about the connections between our RTAs. That's something that we have not made a lot of progress on, the north-south transportation within our region and just the transportation that people do between RTAs and between the MBTA and the RTAs. So Acton is also part of LRTA, but very close to three others plus the MBTA. So I was just commenting on that.
Yeah, that's great. And that's something that, you know, potentially could be addressed with some of the federal funding that is.
Yeah, I mean, so when you asked about RTAs, is there anything, I do want to address those inter-RTA relationships and the MBTA RTA. I appreciate all the attention to that.
Yeah, that's great. Thanks, Rani. Great. So Julie, if you don't mind sharing the deck, my computer has been, you know, not great the last couple of times I shared my screen. So I just didn't want to disrupt this meeting. So just quickly today, I wanted to provide a little bit of an overview of what MAPC is doing with respect to the American Rescue Plan Act funds. That looks perfect. Thanks, Julie. And how we're supporting cities and towns, as well as trying to provide input with the legislature in terms of how the state should spend their allocation of ARPA funds. But I would really, you know, want to leave a lot of time for discussion and hear from you all what your questions are with respect to ARPA and sort of what the conversations are like within your cities and towns in terms of how you're thinking about spending these funds. Next slide, please. So just a very quick high level overview of the American Rescue Plan Act. So this was designed to be the first COVID recovery bill rather than relief bill. Massachusetts cities and towns have received $3.4 billion in ARPA local recovery funds. Sometimes I'll say ARPA when I am specifically referring to the state and local fiscal recovery fund. So I don't mean to be confusing and using those terms interchangeably, because ARPA is really this massive COVID recovery bill, but I am specifically today talking about the state and local fiscal recovery funds. And so as a reminder, I know this group knows this, but funds must be obligated by the end of the year in 2024 and spent by 2026. Next slide, please. So in terms of the eligible uses of ARPA funds, I sometimes actually find it easier to focus on what the prohibited uses are of ARPA funds, because really the eligible uses are quite flexible. So you'll see in the second bullet there are a few places where the ARPA does specifically say you cannot spend your local recovery funds in these buckets. But when you're looking at the eligible uses, and specifically this first bucket on responding to the public health emergency and its negative economic consequences, that's actually quite flexible. And I think if you look at any city or town across the region, you know, you can find an opportunity to make investments that align with that framework. And this third bullet too is really important to MAPC, and it is in the US Treasury guidance. But we think it's really critical to ensure that both at the state and local level, ARPA funds are providing aid to disproportionately impacted communities. And again, whether you're looking at this through the lens of public health, economic development, housing security, what have you, I think, you know, any community can find need and a use for ARPA funds that contributes to this goal. Next slide, please. So what has been guiding our thinking on ARPA funds? So back in March, MAPC released our principles for an equitable and resilient recovery. This was just before I think ARPA was actually signed into law. And our priorities are really grouped into three different buckets. So improving and expanding workforce development, small business support, obviously economic recovery, it's going to be central that we're creating high quality, well-paying jobs. So we wanted to put workforce development, small business support up front, aligning our economic recovery with our climate, housing, and transportation goals. Both at the state and local level, we have a lot of shared identified priorities in these three areas. And I think it's really important that as we're making these transformative investments, we're not losing sight of these goals and these metrics that we've set for ourselves. And then finally, improving connectivity and access and building our digital and public health infrastructure. Kind of a mouthful, but really this is, I think of this last section really about regional resiliency. And so thinking about that, from both a public health and a digital accessibility perspective, I think is going to be really important if we're looking to kind of learn the lessons learned from the past 18 months or so. Next slide, please. All right, so I'm going to unpack each of these a little bit more, but these are really our four main spending principles. For really geared towards the state with respect to spending ARPA funds. But I think there are some common themes here that cities and towns can look to as they're also deciding how to spend their local recovery funds. So if we go to the next slide, I'm just gonna unpack each of these a little bit more. So first and foremost, we think, like I said earlier, it is really critical that ARPA funds are addressing structural inequity in every corner of the Commonwealth. We think it's really important that ARPA funds are being used to confront and dismantle some of these root causes that led to the widely disparate impacts of the pandemic that we saw borne out every day when it comes to public health access, housing stability, who is able to have reliable internet access, things like that. And again, you know, this is really aligned with the US Treasury guidance, prioritizing aid to the hardest hit communities. And we think this is also a good opportunity to partner with trusted community organizations to ensure that aid is reaching those who need it most. Next slide. So next is aligning our ARPA investments with our climate, housing, transportation, and economic development goals. We're a planning agency. We work with you all to do a lot of planning work. And what is so often the barrier that we talk about in different planning documents? Funding. And so now we have this really important opportunity to look to our master plans, our housing production plans, corridor studies, and say, hey, what do we want to advance now that we have this opportunity? And what is something that we can actually move towards the implementation stage? So we think it's really important to look to the planning work that we've already done, look to the studies and the research that has already been conducted, and ideally think about how we can use ARPA funds to meet multiple goals at the same time. So for example, you know, investing in workforce that will advance our decarbonization goals, building affordable housing that is net zero, things like that. Next slide. So we have been talking about at the state level, how can we balance ARPA investments in terms of both strengthening existing programs and piloting innovative ideas? It comes almost trite to say this, but the ARPA really does present an incredible opportunity, an unprecedented opportunity to make some, you know, really important decisions about recovery, but also pilot some ideas that we otherwise would not have the opportunity to do so. So while we think, you know, investing in existing programs that we know are strong, that we know are serving the needs of our communities is important, this also could be an opportunity to pilot new programs, gather the data that we need to make important decisions about whether a future program should become permanent in the long term. Next slide. I think this is our last one. So this is really geared towards the state, but there's not a lot of people saying this, so I do want to just kind of emphasize this point today. We think it's important that the state assumes the COVID-related costs that cities and towns have incurred. So cities and the ARPA funds are really, really flexible. And I think we risk exacerbating inequities if communities that were hardest hit by COVID, who have had the largest public health impact, will then have to allocate a larger share of their ARPA funds towards COVID mitigation. So setting up testing sites, vaccination sites, all of that. And so we believe that the state should assume the COVID mitigation costs, whether that's PPE procurement, setting up those testing and vaccination sites, air quality measures in schools, things like that. Next slide. So just very quickly, and then I want to get to discussion. I just want to highlight a couple of different ways in which MAPC is working on advocating for and supporting our cities and towns in spending ARPA dollars. So we are, I think folks here know, we are the designated economic development district, and we are leading an application for the EDA's Build Back Better Fund. This is another program available through ARPA. We are working with our existing coalitions, including the Metro Mayor's Climate Task Force, to identify regional priorities and share different investment ideas, you know, troubleshoot different questions around ARPA. Emily Torres-Cullinane, who I think might be on the call today, I'm not sure. Her team is leading a project with the city of Somerville to collect public feedback on how local ARPA dollars should be spent. Mark Fine, who's our director of municipal collaboration, is working with a group of North Shore communities to help them sort of unpack the federal reporting requirements for ARPA dollars. We think this is actually like a really worthwhile endeavor. This kind of data is going to be really important to show that Massachusetts, you know, spent ARPA funds in meaningful ways and in transformative ways. And I think this data is actually going to be very useful. So if folks have questions about reporting, we're happy to talk about that further. And then finally, the government affairs team in particular is really busy doing ongoing advocacy with the administration and the legislature as they sort of move through their process for just determining how the state's ARPA dollars will be spent. The last legislative hearing on ARPA funds is actually happening in about 40 minutes. So the legislature has said they are going to come out with their ARPA spending bill, their first possibly ARPA spending bill by November 17th. So we are keeping a very, very close eye on that. I think I might have one more slide, but it's just questions. I want to hear your questions. I know this is kind of a lot to unpack. So I would love to hear what your questions are, what we can potentially help answer about state and local fiscal recovery funds. But I would also just love to hear from this group, if you've made a decision about how you're going to spend your ARPA funds, how did you make that decision? What kind of investments are you looking to make? And if you haven't made that decision yet, is there any kind of support we could offer, or is there any kind of guidance you are looking for in making that decision? Last thing I'll say too, you can take down the slides if you want, Jolie. We held a webinar last month, September was this one, focusing on how cities and towns can make meaningful investments with their ARPA dollars. And so if folks weren't able to attend that, I can drop some of that information into the chat too. It was a good session with the Massachusetts Taxpayers Foundation.
Okay, we have some questions. You raise your hands. We'll try to get to everybody. We got time. I see Susan. Oh, that was quick. Okay, Susan.
I have an ARPA 101 question. Of that $30 billion, what proportion was directly allocated to cities and towns, and what portion of it does the state administer on its own?
So in total, Massachusetts actually got $8.9 billion. That $3.4 all going to cities and towns. The state has their own separate pot of about $5.3 billion that they are determining. To what extent that may go to cities and towns, I think is to be determined. The one thing I will say though is that the governor did allocate $100 million of that $5.3 billion pot to four communities that were hit particularly hard by COVID, and their local allocation from the federal government was not necessarily proportional to the impact that those communities saw. And so that was Chelsea, Methuen, Randolph, I'm gonna say Lawrence, I'll check, but those four communities did receive a portion of the state's ARPA dollars.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Okay, Jennifer, I see everybody hand raised.
Thank you, Bill. On the piece about the idea of the state assuming direct COVID costs instead of it coming out of city and town budgets, I was wondering if there is something that we can do collectively to support that, if it's too late for that, since they're already, I had my phone do something weird. If there's something that we can do to help support that effort, or if it's already past that point.
Yeah, so I don't think there is necessarily a firm deadline by which the legislature is accepting testimony. I do think getting some comments in, if you're interested in offering comments to the Joint Ways and Means Committee sooner is probably better, since they are looking to have a bill by November 17th. So if that's something the group is interested in weighing in on, that would probably be the right avenue, is weighing in with the legislature on that point and any other points that you want to elevate with them in terms of how state spending could complement what you guys are doing at the local level.
Yeah, I didn't know if it was a place for kind of a joint community letter signed on by as many communities as wish to sign on.
Yeah, I think that could be a really interesting opportunity if the group is interested. We're happy to support with that.
Excellent. Okay, any other questions? Got me some.
I have some, no one else has any.
Let's see, okay. Carol?
Janie? Yeah. Oh, Janie's hand's up too, yep.
Oh, okay. Franny?
Hi, yes, Janie Drettler. Thank you very much for putting this on the meeting agenda today. I know that it was quick footwork on your behalf because some of us had asked to have it sooner than later. I will just say that I've done like a deep dive into what all the other communities in Middlesex County have done in terms of planning. And, you know, our board has just started the process with our town manager. And I guess I'm looking for some information about, you know, what are other communities doing in terms of timing? You know, what is the process that they're following? You know, I do have some of this information by just going to, you know, different towns' websites, but, you know, following, you know, what kind of framework to follow. And also when looking at different projects, you know, how do we slice and dice this? And, you know, I think a lot of people will start to come out of the woodwork now for, you know, seeking a portion of these funds, but, you know, having more guidance on that would be really helpful. I thank you very much for bringing it up about having the state pay for or supply funding for PPP, PPE, and those kinds of needs. I think that's really important and obviously very important for the communities to have some more equity. But I guess I'm just looking for more guidance, you know, more structure, if that's possible. Thank you.
Yeah, I don't know if anyone else actually wants to jump in on that. I will just say, so one thing we are doing is circulating a survey to all of the municipal CEOs to gather exactly this information to understand sort of who has already made decisions about how they're spending their ARPA dollars and what was the process that they undertook to make those decisions. I will just say anecdotally, it is very variable across the region, whereas you have communities like Somerville that are doing very, very thorough engagement processes and collecting a lot of information from residents about what they're thinking, whereas other communities, particularly communities that received a smaller portion of ARPA funds, are, you know, are just like, we have this, our capital project backlog, we're just going to start chipping away at that. We're going to invest in the water treatment. We're going to, you know, address these sewer concerns. I think it really runs the gamut, and we are trying to glean that information ourselves. On the public engagement side too, that also has been, you know, pretty across the board. So, you know, that's just to say, stay tuned. We will be circulating that survey, and we're, you know, sort of happy to share those findings as we can.
Thank you. Is that survey going out to select boards or to has it already gone out?
Hasn't gone out yet. I think it's going out to municipal CEOs, but I can double check on that.
So that would be a select board. Or are you talking about a town manager?
Town manager.
Okay. Okay, thank you.
Carolyn?
Sure, thank you. I would just say we're still sort of in the process of developing how we're gonna be allocating the ARPA funds. So we started off with just our senior management team sort of doing brainstorming sessions, but we're bringing it to our select board pretty soon in the next couple of weeks and are going to sort of develop a process from there. I did have one particular question, though, that I haven't found either affirmative or not in the guidance, but there's been a lot of discussion about housing, affordable housing, and can you acquire land with the ARPA funds? I'm not 100% clear on that right now. I mean, you know, certainly we've talked about investing in, you know, capital improvements and things for some of our existing housing stock, but in, you know, the sort of spirit of creating more housing, can you actually purchase land or a building or something to, you know, increase the housing stock, affordable housing stock?
Yeah, that's a really good question. So my understanding is that all funds need to be obligated by 2024 and spent by 2026. So the challenging thing is, yeah, so that acquisition would need to happen and have been paid for by 26. So I think if you do that and you can demonstrate that that land is going to be utilized for affordable housing, I think that it checks all of the boxes. You may want to check with the folks at CHAPA as well. I don't know if you've spoken with them yet.
No, not yet.
They're doing a lot of work on ARPA funds with respect to advancing housing production and housing affordability. they may have run into that question before as well. But I think if all of the funds are spent by 26 and you can demonstrate that this acquisition is to, you know, further affordable housing production, my gut says that would work.
Thank you.
Kate?
First of all, our town is just starting, actually tonight we're having our first ARPA committee meeting, but it never occurred to me that we should be thinking about the state ARPA funds as well as the federal ARPA funds, because we are just, we were just gonna meet about the money that we know we're getting. So I have a number of questions because now we've been, so I wanna make sure when you're talking about CHAPA and working around ARPA, are they working around the federal ARPA or the state ARPA? And so that's one question. The second question is, how do you foresee the state using its ARPA funds as a direct allocation to various towns like the federal one? Or do you think they're going to set up a bunch of grant application programs where then you have to now apply for, you know, specific use of the money? So
yeah, I have more questions.
We'll start with those.
No, that's fine. I got time. So with respect to CHAPA, they've been active at both the state and the local level. Just their advocacy has been trying to guide the state's expenditure of ARPA funds towards housing production, housing affordability, addressing the public housing backlog, things like that. And they did, they're working at the local level as well, trying to just understand how cities and towns are thinking about using their ARPA funds to address local housing needs too. So state and local is primarily where CHAPA is working. I should have said at the outset, you know, Governor Baker actually did put forward a proposal for how the state should spend 50% of its ARPA fund. So he put out a proposal that would cover about $2.8 billion. And he allocated $1 billion of that to housing. And so that includes affordable housing production, expanding the Commonwealth Builder Program, a couple of different programs. I can send this to you all momentarily. So that is sort of that's sort of what's on the table. And so now the ball is in the legislature's court. They're, you know, considering Governor Baker's proposal. They've conducted 6 different public hearings. They're all like 4 or 5 hours long. They are getting a lot of input from different advocacy organizations, residents, on how the state should spend their ARPA dollars. I do think housing will be included ultimately in the state's, whatever the state's decision will be, whatever that bill from the legislature does look like. I think something housing related will be in there, but at least what's been put on the table from Governor Baker is they were looking to allocate a sizable amount of ARPA funds to housing. I don't think that would all necessarily be directly cash to cities and towns, but like I said, investments in existing programs, like Commonwealth Builder, other similar programs like that. I can send you all the actual proposals so you have that too. No.
Okay, Bob has his hand raised there.
Sorry, I thought I was lowering my hand. I'm all set. Oh.
Okay, good. Amanda, you were raised. Are you? I think was.
Yeah, I was raised. I was wondering. So one of the things that the town of Hudson is considering ARPA funding for is to support, you know, public health staffing. And so if we're assuming that the state would, you know, incur the cost of, you know, mitigating COVID-related measures. Would that also be included, like staffing for either public health positions or within health departments?
That's a really good question. The Massachusetts Public Health Association, the organization that I mentioned earlier, that's been very engaged in RTA advocacy, has been really engaged in the state legislature's hearings around how ARPA funds can be used to advance public health. And they've been talking a lot about how do we make our local and regional public health infrastructure more resilient.
So I think it's a both and. What we're really talking about with respect to calling on the state to address COVID mitigation, we're really talking specifically about direct pandemic related public health concerns. And so that is PPE procurement, testing and vaccination sites, any sort of HVAC upgrades or air quality improvements you're going to be making at schools. That's where we think, you know, it makes sense for the state to be taking those on. But things like investments in local and regional public health infrastructure, I think are a both and. I think we definitely need more money from the state to for cities and towns to make those investments. But I think if you are also looking to do that on your own at the local level, I think that's a great way to use ARPA funds too, because that will give you, you know, resiliency in the long haul too with respect to your public health infrastructure. So that's a good distinction. Thank you for asking that.
Okay. Any other questions right now? Gee Liz, that was a lot of information.
I didn't know there were two other questions Kasia had put out too. I was curious if communities have made decisions about ARPA funding, or if you're in the process and wanted to share what that looks like with other communities, that could be helpful for those who are still in the process. Is it Franny?
Yeah.
Well, we're going through the process, and I had a moment of frustration yesterday because the town did a great job of reaching out to stakeholders within the town staff and others and developing a really long list of possible expenditures, but somehow transportation had been left off, except in terms of an EV vehicle purchase, which could be a police or could be a transportation vehicle for getting a smaller one. And so it wasn't until the select board last night was going through and looking at how people responded to all of those through our survey that I realized it last week when our transportation committee came up with a proposed use for ARPA funds, but there we were going through it and they didn't have any input from people because it wasn't on that initial list. So when they survey people, do you want this? Do you want this? If you don't have a specific transportation ask, it's not there. And so that's just to sort of keep in mind, to sort of keep a loose, not get too tight with the process, I would advise. Because if you do, if you've missed something, you might be looking at the wrong set of choices. So that's all.
Okay. Anybody else? Oh, Jill.
Yeah, thanks. So I know that Carolyn sort of said, you know, we're sort of very much at the starting phase of this. We've, you know, had staff surveyed, and we're going to be discussing this soon. So as far as process, that's kind of where we are. But I have a question that just occurred to me as I'm listening to what other people are doing. And Acacia, maybe this is something you can answer. We are also looking at several recreation projects right now. And it seems to me that that may also be something that's sort of improving access and utility of community resources, particularly outdoor resources, could also be potentially admissible. Would that also be acceptable uses of ARPA funding?
Yeah, I think it depends on the exact recreation investment, but in my mind, that also feels like a public health investment in certain ways too, getting people outside and more active and, you know, making more green space available for people. So as long as you can sort of make that connection in alignment
with the transition. So I'm wondering, even, you know, one of the things we're looking at, and Carolyn's going to roll her eyes in a second on the other side of the screen here, but, you know, we're even looking at projects like, you know, improving, you know, restroom facilities or adding restroom facilities in order to make it safer for people to keep using and to encourage more people out. I think I could draw that line pretty reasonably. And I'm wondering if that's something that, you know, sort of increases access for more people.
But I was just going to say, that seems like an accessibility investment too. And, you know, Julie just messaged me too, and then she's totally right about this. I mean, recreation investments can also address stormwater issues too, which that is expressly addressed in the Treasury guidance. So yeah, I mean, I think as long as you are avoiding the prohibited uses and you're looking at sort of the examples provided by the Treasury, I think in terms of advancing public health and making these amenities more accessible to your residents, that to me seems like it would be in alignment with the guidance.
That's awesome. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Any other questions we have? Still have some time. Somebody has their hand raised. Who is that?
I think that's Jill from before. But okay. I did have a question, Kasia. I didn't know if you could describe a little more the process that Somerville is using for engagement and if there's any ideas from that process that might make sense for Magic communities to consider that they might be able to take on.
Yeah, you know, it's interesting because I've been having more conversations with Emily and Christian Brandt on our community engagement team about right-sizing engagement. And so Somerville is, I actually don't know the details of their process, but Somerville being a larger community does have a sizable amount of ARPA funds that they are working with. And so my understanding is they're looking to do a variety of kinds of public forums or surveys, just trying to get input from their residents in terms of how ARPA funds should be spent. But I think, you know, and it's a, you know, very thorough process. Our comms, our community engagement team has been really, really working very closely with the staff over there in Somerville. But the thing that Emily and Christian and I have been talking about too is like, do you ever run the risk of doing too much engagement? And you know, we have all of these great planning processes that have taken place in our cities and towns. And we've heard from residents, you know, what they want through master planning efforts, through transportation plans, things like that. So I think we're talking more and more about how do we keep the public informed and engaged and interested in what's going on and aware of this great opportunity, but also just not oversaturating people and just asking people again and again, what do you want to see? So, and I don't mean to say that the Somerville process is like that. It's a large community with really engaged residents. But we've just been talking about if other communities are interested in something like that, what is the best model? And I think for smaller communities, you know, that it's going to look different everywhere. So if you're interested in learning more about what Somerville is doing, there's other cities and towns. I think some communities have actually created like a pseudo participatory budgeting kind of process as well. So there's a lot of different ways that your residents can get plugged in. Surveys are really common too. Emily Torres-Colonine can speak to a whole wealth of different, different solutions that communities are pursuing. She's been doing some national research as well too, which has been interesting.
Oh, okay. Julie and Kasia, just to be to tell for the membership, are you going to be able to distribute the PowerPoint from that Kasia just did? That was excellent. I think everybody would enjoy having access to that.
Yeah.
The second question I have, Julie, when we record these meetings, are they going to be on the Magic website, or where would somebody find them if they want to use them as a reference?
I think we can post them on the Magic website. Right now, there's a team member I have to send everything to get it posted, but I'm working on getting direct access so I can just post everything a little quicker, hopefully. But that's where I can put the slides and the recordings in the future and try to put agendas. And if I ever can't, I try to send out an email blast. I think you guys are all on the Magic email list too, so hopefully get things that way too.
I think that'd be great. And I think everybody really appreciate having, you know, access to the materials after the meetings, because now I know that I'd like to show this to a couple of people in town. Two more. Jennifer has a question, and then Franny.
I was just going to come back to wondering if there is any interest among the towns that are here on considering signing on to some kind of joint letter supporting the idea of the state covering direct COVID costs, and a thumbs up or a thumbs down or anything would be helpful. And if so, then, you know, I'd be happy to work with Julie and Kasia maybe to find out sort of what are the key points that we'd be trying to raise. Yeah. All right, at least some interest. Okay, thanks.
Oh, yeah. Sounds like a popular
initiative. I'll reach out and see if we can put something together.
Excellent. Okay, great. Okay. Oh, Tranny?
Yeah. I'm sharing a long text because I wanted to share the invitation to the next RTAAC. It's the RTA Advancement. No. Advocate Coalition, who are, it was put together by the Massachusetts Public Health Association and T4MA. So if you are interested in going to their things, it's in that long chat I just left, as well as an announcement of something that I can see that MAPC is involved with. So I just wanted to share that. And I also shared a list because at the last RTA Advocates Coalition meeting, that man Phineas Baxendahl shared a really great interactive list, you know, linkable of all the COVID funding and how it related to transportation. So it was very useful. I just couldn't get a hold of the link, but I wanted to share those.
That is a long text there, but maybe if somebody wants to get hold of, maybe they can email you directly too if they need to.
Absolutely. I'll just write my email in here. But also his email is in there, so that would be better.
Thank you.
Anyway,
just wanted Kate, to did you have something else? Kate?
Yeah, I just wanted to actually piggyback on Jennifer's idea for the letter. And especially I want the state to reimburse us for items that we bought to give vaccinations in town, because they told us that those vaccinations were going to be handled locally. And then they pulled the rug out from under our feet at the last minute. So we're stuck with a $100,000 tent in which we were going to give, drive through vaccinations. So I am madder than heck, because this is a huge, that, you know, represents a really big, you know, chunk of money that we put out, and CARES and FEMA don't want to cover it because it didn't get to be used.
Oh, great. Good information. See, we have any other hands? Okay, I think it's, any last questions here before we, so far we're right on schedule, I think, with our super duper long meeting.
Yes. As folks are thinking of any last questions or comments that they have, Franny just reminded me, we are also hosting a webinar tomorrow on the future of work. It's gonna be with Lizzie Wyatt moderating the discussion. Connor Gately from our data services team is gonna be talking a little bit about some of the research that MAPC is beginning to do around this very big question that we are all asking. We're also going to have Jared Johnson from Transit Matters and Scott Mullen from Battery City speak about some of the ways in which they are thinking about the future of work. I think we are getting more questions about this and doing more research around, you know, given that the future of work and the future of commuting, all of this is uncertain. What does this mean for staying on track with respect to our transportation goals, reducing GHG emissions, ensuring housing affordability, all of that. I will drop a link to the chat in case, but maybe Julie beat me to it. She did. Great. Thanks, Julie.
Bill, I would like to just say something, add something. Through all these discussions, the thing we never talk about is the North-South rail link. And I just wanted to mention that, because talk about things that would pick up our economic development, connecting our two transportation systems. And I sometimes hold back from ever mentioning it, because for some reason there's like radio silence from our governor and from that various organizations, I attribute it to Big Dig trauma, but it is so important to our whole region and New England. And so I think we need to just keep mentioning it. So I wanted to throw it out there. When I hear about this much spending to try to work, that would be a really wonderful thing to start on.
That's a great point, Freddie. That's right. It just kind of drops off every now and then. Mm-hmm. It's such a huge thing.
Especially during the pandemic.
Yeah. Okay. Let's see, Julie, for next, our next meeting is, we're still on November 16th with our diversity, equity, and inclusion part one.
Yep. November 16th. And then I believe December 5th, I sent out calendar.
The 5th or 7th?
7th, whatever that Tuesday is. Thank you.
Okay. All right. Yes.
December is coming up, surprisingly. Those two special sessions will be with Dr. Raul Fernandez, who's a specialist in diversity, equity, and inclusion, and a Brookline Select Board member. So he'll be leading two sessions, the first on transportation and housing, and the second one on municipal governance and finance. And we'll send out a description of those events to you in advance. You can share it with others in your community who might be interested, particularly Select Board members, Planning Board members, other volunteer committee members, and municipal staff. We'd really encourage you to invite many people to attend, and we'll also record them so they're available as a future resource too. And there's a link to register for the meeting that you have in your calendar invite, and I'll also just pop it in the chat here, and you'll hear from me more about it in the interim. So,
and that's a 9 a.m. start, right? On that?
Yeah, 9 to 10:30.
And we, so far as when we were looking at if there are any other dates that had to move around, so far we're okay with everything, I think, right?
Okay. Yep. I think the major adjustment was we added ARPA to this meeting and made it longer, but I think we'll try to avoid 2 hour meetings when we can, because we know that is very long for everybody. So we'll try to keep to an hour and a half, but thanks for so many people for sticking with us this long.
Okay. Any last questions? I think we're pretty much ready to wrap up. I think we got you a little early even. Okay. Well, thank you everybody for a terrific session here. I think that was a very useful. And the materials, again, having those available, I think will be something that we can use to further involve our your community's leadership and hopefully make some inroads with a lot of these programs going on. All right. I think that's, anybody else have any closing comments? All right. Well, thank you, everybody. We'll see you next month and maybe sooner even.
Hey, thank you, Kasia.
Thank you.
Bye-bye. Thanks a lot.